Okay. I'm Bert. Actually, I'm not Bert. My name is Bert, but probably nobody can say that, but yeah. Everybody called me Bert. I'm here for the Phoenix. This is the Phoenix 2. I designed it, I think, 12 years ago. It was a joke because I make a synthesizer for somebody and I tried a synthesizer, but I cannot hear anything because it's only CVs. So I decided to make this one. I'm not a musician. I'm only a technician. So if you want to know about the synthesizer, yeah, I can say what's inside. It's resistors, capacitors. And you have to say how it sounds. But I'm not a musician. My original work was, let's say, 40 years ago, maybe. I work at Synton, a Dutch company we're making vocoders and synthesizers and so on. And later I go to another job, I make machines. I work at measure equipment and that kind of thing. And at a certain time, somebody asked me, can you make something with music? Okay, and then I make the Phoenix one. That was just for fun. And the Phoenix 3 came out, and then I decided to make the Phoenix 2. That's my story. My background is, I told you, I'm not a musician, I'm a technician, but I like doing things different because I'm thinking as a technician. I like to do a different thing because I see that, I can do that and do that, not listening to that, but from technician side, I make that module. The Phoenix is also built by that idea. Some modules has only inputs, not attenuators. I didn't put attenuators in it because when every module has extra knobs, you never use them or sometimes. So I put the knobs away and put mixes on it. So you have to patch things. Things are related to each other. There is a band filter on it, a format filter with several inputs. And I say, okay, I can put an envelope on it or I can put an LFO on it, but okay. I made that, then the three LFOs. So there's one LFO with three outputs where you can shift the phase of that. So that's meant for the format filter, but you can use them also for everything else. There is I told you I made the sequencer before, and here inside is a small sequencer. And if the flux is running, then okay, it's fine, but it's annoying that I make an LFO with has a, what do you call it? I call it swing LFO. It's not swing, but it has a certain frequency you can set. And every 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, oh, this is the wrong one. Yeah. This one. Every 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 pulses out, it start to another frequency. And you can set that. So you have tick, 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 tick. So you, the time between those, you can vary. That's I want have to make for the sequencer. So it's a combination of things. So I make a sequencer and okay, I need that clock. And so it's a combination. So everything is inside that I want to build and not people ask for it. So people ask for things, but I don't like those things, so I don't put it in. I put the things in I like, and that's it. Yeah, I don't know. Do you know the Phoenix? Who knows the Phoenix? Who played the Phoenix? You know? Oh. Oh, you have a lot of customers there. he is now making that. I did a reissue a year, 2 years ago, because I have a lot of parts left over. So I make a reissue of the two, and yeah, now the parts are gone. So I never made a big, never make a large of quantities. I make, see it as a project. I make them and then I stop, and then I don't like them to produce anymore, and then I design other things. Yeah, I can hear that to you, but I don't know what's happening. There is only one PCO and one filter. I can show you the modules, but maybe it's better to, if somebody has questions, then ask me, then I know which direction you want to know something about the Phoenix.
You said you only put things into it that you liked.
Yes.
And you also said that you're not a musician.
Yes, so but from the technician side, a technician, yeah. But the interaction of the modules. Yeah, but I'm not a technician.
Yeah.
But I work at Sinton, and we did a lot of modelers, and I designed also the C-rings at that time. So I know what filters are, what oscillators are, so I know what they're doing.
Are you listening a lot when you're designing, or are you?
No, I never. No, the Phoenix, that's a good question. I designed the Phoenix 1, I never listened to it. And when I decided to make the 2, okay, I said, okay, I have to listen to the 1. Okay, and that's the first time I listened to the 1. And okay, and then, maybe I should that different or others. But I never, no, I cannot make music. I tried, but I can read notes, because you can learn that, but that's it. I know a C. I know how a C sounds, because I calibrate a lot of oscillators, so, and I know octaves, I can hear that, but I cannot play.
What was your criteria for it's done?
It's no criteria. It's never done.
Of course.
That's my done. My.
But when do you give up then?
No. I never give. That's a discussion I had that when I work at Sinton. My boss say stop. It's enough.
Too much man-hours.
No, I don't know. No, that was a different company. We came there and we started at the table with coffee at, let's say, 11 o'clock, and if it's we talk, and we say, hey, it's 3 o'clock already. We talk about things like this, or about everything, but my boss said, okay, if you want a thing, that it should be ready at a certain point, and then it's called in production, and you cannot change everything every time. So it's not, this is not finished. If I do it again, I do it different.
But so what are some examples of things that you added that were most interesting to you as a technician?
Yes, I'm added as a technician.
Yeah.
Yeah, it maybe is not really too, I'm not a musician, I know what I'm doing. Expert, I cannot I know the modules, so I add something to the modules, something extra that I like or as a technician.
So like, what are some of those extra things that you add?
Yeah, for instance, you're hearing this one. It's only one oscillator because this is one output, but it has internal LFOs inside, so it's a mix of, yeah. It's not one shape. Another thing is that I'm listening also to people, and I read forums and so on. And one of the discussion was going on at the time was everybody wants to have an envelope generator which was fast. Okay, what is fast? 1 milliseconds, and you hear only a click, something like that. And okay, I can do that, but that's. What I get also ideas, so I have in this envelope generator, I have between the tech and the K a hold function. That it means that it's you get this and then you get a hold, and so you have more energy and that thing, you get more punch on it.
Uh-huh.
So somebody wants to have fast envelope generator and say, okay, but I don't like them because I think that for me it's useless, but I'm not a musician. but I add the whole function in it. Another thing is the noise. Can I hear that? Let's hear. There is an analog noise and a digital noise. Analog noise is everybody knows white noise and something like that. I have also a digital one. And the digital one has a clock because it's digital. So I say, okay, I will vary the clock. It's also in the Phoenix One. So you have a variable clock. It's not a big thing, I think, but that's your question is what, how do you, how I think is, this is the one. Yes, the envelope generator is still on. So I vary the clock here because I see it's an oscillator. So why should I not vary it? So that's why. It's not music, and people like it sometimes. And but it's only an idea I got and put it in. And there are more of those things. If there is something, another thing is here, there is a wave multiplier. What's a wave multiplier? I call it that way. It's a kind of sequencer. There's four steps. But there's four steps, and if I patch it here, wave multiplier, outputs, it has a clock in, but it's quite, this one. It going through the four steps. If I slow this down, you see this. But the idea was not to build this one. The idea was to build a VCO, oscillator, I say, with a kind of burst oscillator, with a lot of parameters, and then I need a second oscillator for the time. You have here the time. That's you have a burst 1, 2, 3, 4, and you have a delay after those bursts. So you have pulse wave. So that time should be, if you want to have a musical thing, you should be 1 full octave. So I make that module. It has 10 knobs, it has 20 inputs. I listen to it and I say, okay, it works. So I sized that down to the minimum thing was left, and it was this one. And this one you can use for CVs because it's four steps. It has audio range. It's but if you can add, now it's a DC input on this. If I connect this input to the same sine wave, then I have the sine wave as the replacing the DC as it plots. So there is now a sine waves and an amount of. This is the delay. And there is a clock device in here, so you can divide it by two or before. It's a module which I original designed as VCO. And I stripped it because, if you have this size of oscillator and you like it this way, then I think, okay, nobody wants it. I decided for you. So I make this one. That's the way I think.
One question I didn't understand it. Since either it's analog or digital, or it's a combination of both?
This is complete. No, this is this. Is except for the digital noise, it's analog.
Oh.
Sorry. And this version has also a BBD delay. So an BBD, you know what it is?
Yeah.
That delay is inside, so it's maybe digital, but that thing is original.
It's great time.
It's a sampler, so it's analog.
The digital noise, is it a shift register?
Yes. Okay. Yes. And this one there's a different one as in the original one because the chips are. The thing is that at the time I made the Phoenix 2, I could not get. The special chips for the VCOs, and you can only buy op amps and that sort of things. So it was complete hybrid, builds with normal components. This one now you cannot get and Vectrols. The filter was also a Vectrol filter, but Vectrols are not available anymore. So I had to change from Vectrols to other chips. So there was a difference in the components here. But for me, it's no problem. But for some people, they like Vectrols, but it's fine. And this one is no Vectrol. In the original, there were Vectrols. But I think this one sounds brighter as the other thing. And the thing is that in this version, you have a resonance input for the format filter, and with Vectrols it's hard to get the resonance inputs. So it's analog, but different than the early version because I cannot get the parts from that time.
Actually, it probably has better parts in terms of tolerance.
What's better?
Better in terms of,
That's a discussion I always have with some people. They like the Moog system because they have aging the power supply and aging components, and that's why it sounds better. I cannot hear it, but I'm not a musician. Maybe it could be sound different, but different is not worse or bad or better.
No, I'm just being objective.
There are in this one there are more modern. No, it's not modern. There are new components which we made from earlier days. But at that time I designed that, the old components were not available anymore. I'm talking about the curtain chips and that kind of things, and they are now available. And VCAs, there are still the old OTA VCAs and such. Hi. No more questions? Oh.
So between the 2010 version of the Phoenix 2 and the current one being made today, were those the changes that you were talking about? Or were you talking about the Phoenix 1?
No, those versions is different. The two original 2 and this one for 2.2. This has, for instance, people ask me with a delay inside BBD delay, and people ask sometimes I want to have a smaller delay and somebody wants to have a longer delay. Now you cannot get a long delay with BBD, so I add the two chips inside, so you can switch between the one chip, other chip, or you can parallel both, use both. So that's different. The other one has, because you see here there's not so many space because it was not there, a switch. It had only one, and this has two. What's the difference?
Is one
delayed than
the other?
Hmm?
And the two delays in there?
There are two delays, one of 1,000 steps and one of 4,000 steps. So, and you have designed by the clock, so you don't have a lot of delay. If you want to have delay, buy a delay. Yeah. It's only for effects. And maybe in the original one, and that's never came out, although it came out, there are a few of them, there was a stereo phaser inside. But a phaser takes a lot of components, a lot of room. So why should I put in a lot of components for a stereo delay, a stereo phaser? So I took it out. Maybe that's also something I said here. The phaser, for instance, that's typical me. I have a feedback knob, but it's not working. There's a feedback now. It's not working because I was thinking if you have a working feedback, then it's always fixed to one output, because feedback is output to the inputs. So I put an input for the feedback, and because I have four outputs. I have an output of tab 8, tab 9. I have an output with mixed original and I don't know. Maybe let's say the output of the phaser and the negative inputs, and this is the positive inputs. But you can feedback use all those outputs for feedback. So you can choose which output you're using for the feedback instead of the fixed output. You can also use that input going to the delay. I never tried, but I'm thinking about that. Just from delay input phaser. Output of this one, and it feedback to that. So you can do more with it than only a fixed one. So. But that's for me as a technician. I don't know how it sounds. You have to try. Another thing is, I spoke to a lot of people, and they show me their patches, and okay, for instance, people with the MOG system and MOG model learner, they have an oscillator, they go to a filter, and the filter goes to a VCA, and they have an envelope generator to the filter, and an envelope generator to the filter and the VCA. And they only use the K of the filter. Most people are not you, but other people are not using a complete envelope generator for the filter, only for the decay. So you have. So what I did is I have an envelope generator here, which has a separate output, two outputs, one only decay. So this can you use for the VCA, and this has decay, and this has also Lin lock. You can Lin curve or lock curve. So this you can use for the VCF, and this using for. But that's only watching people, and I say, okay, why should I put in two envelope generators? Finally, in a while, now three three envelope generators. So a normal envelope generator. That's this one. Oh, this one I made complete voltage controlled. Oh, that's also something what I like. When I'm doing those things, I was thinking, okay, what should I do? Okay, I want to add some dynamic in the sounds because everything is same. So I add an attack level. An attack level is the level above the sustain, and that's voltage controlled. So you can control the peak above the sustain level. If you have a sustain level maximum, then there's nothing left. But if you have, then you can add some more dynamic to the sounds. So it's. I was thinking, how can you use things and how to put it in?
Yeah.
Can you show us like the phaser, like some quick patches of. Just show us
the big patches.
Well, you know, like what you like to do with the phaser or something, or the
ring
modulator.
Oh, the ring modulator. Yeah. I don't know, maybe. Let's something else. I will show you what's inside. There are three VCOs inside. VCO one has a short triangle sine, a pulse with pulse width. It has that square with internal LFOs, so you have a pulse width inside added to this. Then, what's this? This curve. Oh, sync. You can sync those things, and this has a variable sync. You can sync off, soft. You want to hear?
Sorry.
You don't want to hear me talking, so.
I want to hear you talking.
Yes. Why don't I hear anything? I don't know what's happening, but I'm doing wrong.
With the volume of the phaser?
This one is working. Oh, yeah. I use outputs. This is the outputs. I use the color green for audio, black is input, blue is CV or audio, it's the same, because in the audio there is a capacitor and here's not. And yellow are outputs which you can sum together. So the outputs, and you can sum those together. So you have now, this is the gates out of the sequencer, so you have two outputs of the. So this is output. Sync. But I put it in the wrong one. these are the variable shape. It's only the. So this is all. It's variable shape. Now the other ones doesn't have that, because you have them here. You don't need them here. It has seen. This one VCO has a kind of strange signal. There are two pulses, and each pulse can be pulsed with modulations and the other, and you can do the phase. So you have a pulse, the original one, and you can move this one about the original one, and you can do pulse with modulation. And these are two outputs, and these are summed together. Also sync, FM. This one has not so much. Oh, it has a...
Has linear FM, right?
Oh, this one has also, this one. This is, the picture is different. He wants a different picture. These are sub-outs. So you have a divider, and this divider you can... I cannot hear let you hear that, but it's, or maybe in this way. You can modulate the phase to the original one. I like the phase shifting. But it's not. You hear some movement. It's a little, but it's the surface is a little bit shifting to the original one. Okay. This has a sawtooth output. So these are the three oscillators, the one mixes. This is a stage variable filter. I like the stage variable filter. I think that's one of the better filters there is, but everybody else likes the 24 dB filter. It has a high pass, low pass, band pass, notch filter out. Okay. It's a notch. You can also use this as an oscillator. The thing is that with the filter is you get a better sine wave. It's more less distorted, and you can also do those kind of effects. Oh, then I use the high pass. Your ring filter. Okay, this is 24 dB filter. The reason that there are three outputs, there is not, somebody asked me, I don't hear the difference between those outputs. Yes, they are all low pass filters. If you listen secure at the end, then you hear the difference. But the reason that I have the outputs is not because I want to have three outputs, because there's a phase relation between those. You can use this left and this right, and then you hear some spacey effects. It's not the filter. This is not the 12 dB output. It's the phasing. That's why I put it in. But I like that idea, not that I have no output. So you can use this as a voice in stereo output. So put this in left and right. Can I show it? now, nobody is saying that I'm doing wrong. Yeah, you have to, with the headphone you can hear it better, but it's, there's a phase, it's a different phase as this one, and that if you, then you hear something in your head. Okay, then we have a next filter. This one, everybody know the low pass filter. That no pass filter is not because we want to have a low pass filter. It's there because I have a noisy delay line. I come back to that later. But that that filter has, it's a normal low pass filter. Well, it's okay. Boring. So I add a gate and trigger input in it, and it's not a factual. A factual has some. If you use a factual, then you get some delay at the if you switch it on. It's not fast. It's slow. So I what can I do? Okay, I put a release on it. So. And I make the release longer. This one. This is LFO 1. So I put a release time on it. So we have a little bit different module as low pass gate. Okay, it has a trigger, it has a gate. So the gate is when the gate is on, then the filter is open, and if the input is low, then you get that. And there is a CV input that's following. The kind of normal filter. This is not one octave, not it's simple linear. We have also here now the forward filter. Forward filter has, this is not spectral, it has a low pass, has band pass and 1, 2 and 3, and it has a mix. A mix is between those and those three and the low pass. You have them up now. Please for you. Another signal. So, these are if you put it this direction, you have only the low pass, and if you put it that's, you only have this one. The thing is that this is a new version with the discrete components. It has a resonance input, and we have to find out what should be the initial resonance. If you have a forward filter, then you have normally already a high Q, high resonance. But this is low because how do you set it? High, but you have a Q in, you can change the Q at the input. I never tried that, but. So you okay? You can do that. This has a low pass output. It has a low band pass output from 1 and 2, yes, and output of 3 RL, and this is summed. So you can, if you want to make it stereo, and everybody wants to do it stereo, then you can patch 3 to left and the other one to right, and then you have kind of stereo filter. Yeah.
Can you show us the wave multiplier? Please.
Okay. West is boring.
No, it's not. It's my favorite, sorry.
You know that thing. Okay, then I go to this one. It has, I will display this. This is the output section. The output section has a mix input, so for the left and right here, but with really not left and right, because you can pan this one to this output. I understand some people it's confusing, but you can pan this to left and right, and normally let's do here. These are voltage controlled, and the other thing is there is a VCA inside, so you can also use this. Now it's a VCA. So the output module, you have a VCA inside, panning, mixing, and that kind of thing. The other thing is the input section. The input section, you can, they put an instrument. Maybe the level is maybe too low, but input, you have an output, audio output. Then you have an envelope of the input signal. You have a trigger. That's when there is a change, a positive change. Then you get a trigger. Maybe I can show that. And there is a gate. So, and that you can use for envelope and that kind of thing. But she wants to have anything else. What we tried yesterday, I believe we tried this. Audio to. But this is normally modulating a ring modulator with that, and triggering. But then I have to build a complete patch. Oh. Okay. You can use this for an instrument, and you can that instrument go to your synthesizer. It's a user interface. Everybody knows VCAs. Slew limiter. Slew limiter is, I put a slew limiter in because I want to have a slide on the sequencer. You can switch, it has an input for switching on and off. If there's no signal, and then it's on. You can control the voltage. For maybe glide, but you can do also using that as a filter for the noise or something else. It's basically also a filter. Then I have, let's see, 5 LFOs. LFO 1 is Yeah, that's weird. That's something I did because, it could be done. It has a CV input, it has a resonance input, it has a triangular input, output, a square output, and yeah, it's an inverse output. So, but it's not inverse because it's zero to positive. So, but this is inverse and to this. And the reason is, I like to do things feedback. Okay. So this is a normal triangle, but if I feed back on the CV to this output, you have a fast attack or faster attack at the decay, and then put back to this, it starts slow. And if you use feedback on the, you cannot hear it, then you get a different shape. All the LFOs has resets, so if you reset, then it starts again. LFO 1 and 3 are the same. They have duty cycle settings. LFO 2 is a simple LFO, it has a sine wave, triangle and square, and these are you call it plus minus, and these are only plus output, so it goes to zero. LFO 4, what is that? Oh yeah, that's the swing LFO. Yeah, it's now only maybe I have to use an envelope. So you get more normal pulses and then one other pulse. And this is the time from I call it the swing pulse, that's the one pulse that's different. And you can, if you do this in the middle, then it's normal. If I do it's long and the other one is short. And this one is harder to hear, but these are an LFO with three triangle outputs. And this is the, let's say, the fixed output. And these two are shifting in phase. You can shift the triangle to the one, 280 degrees. And they are separate, so this, and you can do it manually. And you can do it with fault controls. Sampled holds. Everybody knows sampled holds. Or are you sleeping? No? Sampled holds, normal sampled holds. Weight multiplier. Yeah, that's, I let you hear. That's kind of sequencer. You can use this for. If I have a filter, but that's a tricky thing I now doing. Go in the clock. And now I have here 4 steps. CV steps, so normal sequencer. It's synced with this clock. So if I use this one and go to in the filter. What what's happening is that the original square now, but you can do everything else, square is going to the filter and it goes to the wave multiplier. And that wave multiplier gives some steps in sync with the oscillator. And you can divide it. So you can use it as a voltage controlled modifier. Modify the voltage control to the filter, but you can also use this audio, because if you put in the input, you have two inputs here. One is for step A and C, and the other one is for B and D. And if you use only this one, then all the input here goes to the four of those. So you can, yeah, you can do crazy string, I think, but that's, so I have now a clock from this one, yeah, I do it wrong, this one, this VCO, I can, and I can use the, now it's for all, but I have put in the third one. So I have this is the clock, and these two are scanning, and then this one. Okay. I'm not physician. Yes, both multiplier, mixers, sequencer, but everyone knows sequencer. It's a simple sequencer with 8 steps. You can see it's running, and you can use this one to where is that? To set it at the reset. No, this one. Yes, you can shorten the sequence steps, or you can use this as a single one. Where is that? This one. Where's the comparator? Here. So you can trigger it. That's fine. Oh, this is the comparator. Oh, no, this is the input. So it's running one time, so you can use this as a kind of envelope if you want. You can use overrule the clock. You can, it's a sequencer. I think we have the phaser. Oh, you want to add the other? The phaser. Oh, that's what she asking me. It is without feedback, and you can add, so I have here, it's also voltage control, but okay. It's a phaser.
So, as a little background, I was super lucky in that I found out about the Phoenix One when it was coming out. I think it made 100 units or something.
Yes.
And
you picked it up.
I picked it up from Mark from his barge in Amsterdam. Yeah, it was nice. Showed me all his old Synton stuff. And then I love the Phoenix One. I love the sound of it. And I would say for both the Phoenix One and the Phoenix Two, which I also bought when it came out, that you say it's not, you're not a musician and it's not musical, and it's not a term I'm a big fan of either. But I will say, I think it is incredibly musical, the sound of the thing and the variety of features and what you might want to apply to do certain things and why you might want to do that is really awesomely implemented. And the features of the oscillators, I don't really keep up with Eurorack, but certainly at the time this came out, there was nothing like it that had these features and with the sound. So I think you were incredibly modest about that. And I can't recommend it highly enough, really. It's one of my favorite synths. I had a Surge system before, which is much more expensive. And it's a very precise, almost scientific instrument, I would say, and has its features, which are awesome. But what really fixed my modular system was actually the two Phoenixes. And so I sort of thank you for making them. And also when you made them, they were, you know, it's for the for what it provides, it's a very modestly priced, I feel, for what it provides in this day and age. And the variety, I mean, all the oscillators having a totally different design, the filters having the variety between them, the envelopes, particularly having like the second output on the envelope, useful for voltage controlling itself as well. Just really nice features. It really, if I had to use the word, musical. I don't want you to feel that. I talked to you the other night a little bit about Dutch music, Dutch electronic music, and Stein, and Michael Weissvis, and this whole. There was clearly a really interesting electronic environment in Holland in the 70s or in the Netherlands.
Yes, it was. If you now have our manufactory, then you have deadlines and must be produced cheap and everything else. And at that time, okay, we do that. And okay. Time and it wasn't important. The people are, I think, had a lot of creativity. A lot of people there who are teaching at the musical schools, like Stockhauser people and that kind of things. They do crazy things and they're teaching that to the students. And it's now you cannot study that anymore. It's you study how a sequence in a computer is working, and sometimes. But at that time, it's only crazy thing they did with tape recorders and tape loops and springs with everything else, and also electronic devices like that. It was a nice time to do that, and there were a lot of people there who designed things like the Stein people.
Yeah. I think Stockhausen actually used Synton stuff, did he not?
I don't know.
I think he's listed as
well. I don't know. We make a lot of studios, electronic studios at that time.
And Synton was a distributor for other companies as well?
Synton was original manufacturing. And then the other manufacturing. It's at that time that the DX7 came out. And that changed everything. And nobody wants to buy. At that time, everybody bought a new synthesizer every 3 years, because every 3 years a new generation of synthesizers came out. But when the DX7 came out, everything changed. So we stop producing, we make the ceilings and we make the modular systems and we make for coders, but stop at that. And we have good connection to other people like Lynn, like for the people of Fairlight, EMU, Sequential, Dave Smith, and Oberheim, Bob Moog, and that kind of people came every time to Breukelen, you are Breukelen, Brooklyn, Breukelen. And so we started to go into distribution. But also at that time, it's a few years, Moog, Sequential, EMU, NIN get also the same problems we have because there are cheaper brands and cheaper machines and so on. So at that time, Insonic came out and we bought a distributor for Europe at that time.
So they were part of EMU, right? Insonic?
No. Now they're bought by Creative Audio.
We made sound cards for a while, I think.
Yes, but that's so the market are changing and you have to go with it. But also, Sonic is gone. But I think those are well interesting instruments.
For sure.
If I look at Moller Grid, probably everybody knows, and I was looking at that for envelope generators, and I say 100 envelope generators, and what do you do? Everything do the same. I don't understand that.
Yeah.
At that time, there was a complete different vibe. Everybody do something different. And maybe that's the thing that I do.
So. Yeah, I feel like you took stuff away, some influences from different places and kind of compiled them in a really awesome way.
Now, the other thing is, what I believe is, but that's only for me, is that if you can buy all those stuff on Moller Systems. You can buy all the modules. Probably you are more expensive then, but you can buy. You can buy them, but if you put them together in a case, it will not sound the same. And it's not because the modules are different, but the layout is different. I think the layout, how it's positioned, what it's also making your sounds. Because you patch something here, that was because you see that and you see that and you see that. And you try things, and if you have a different layout, you do something different. That's what I think.
Yeah.
And the user interface is important for the sounds.
I think it's hard to beat the fixed format modular when it's been well designed, which I think this has. So I think it's a really nice combination, the amount of stuff that you get in such a small area of real estate.
Yeah.
And I mean, with modulars, there's always some issues that you have to deal with. But I think it's a good compromise. The only thing I would like to have seen is color coding between all the oscillators, say, all so it's super quick. See on the panel.
I can give you address of a painter.
I'm sure. I'm sure it'd be an expensive job. But, it's always.
You can buy that.
Color name.
Yes.
You were talking with Darren about maybe you had some ideas for new designs as well. You're still thinking about different designs.
I never stop thinking. I pour every 5 years a complete box away with every designs because I try things and okay. And if it is I like it, then I keep it longer. It goes in the next batch to throw away. But I never stop designing in my head, and if I have ideas, then I...
Yes. I never used one, but this had a companion sequencer, didn't it? The spec of it is awesome, I have to say. If I had one,
the sequencer is a strange thing. Somebody wants to have a sequencer, I made them. And I don't like the sound of it, so I have to make the sequence synthesizer of it. And I get in production and okay, how many I should make? Maybe a few. So I made, I think 25 or something like that. I don't know. I really don't know. Yeah. But they are sold out 10 times earlier than the rest.
Yeah, really. Because it is such a unique design. I think Aphex Twin has one, right?
I don't know.
He has the Phoenix 1 and Phoenix 2, because I remember telling him about this offer when it was around. And
I do not met often Phoenix users, so when they are shipped and talk to somebody and I hear a name, I say, hey, remember that? Because I shipped the Phoenix to him, but he is from one band. But they are not never used on stage. And I know, you know, the Phoenix 4, that is somebody making, has made them in Amsterdam. I helped them, they use the analog part of this one and they design the digital parts. I don't know its name again, that person who write music.
Hans Zimmer.
Hans Zimmer bought that and he liked that and he bought another one.
Well,
so they are used in several places. You never know.
Yeah. I think because there weren't many of them originally. Mm-hmm. They were a hard thing to find. They immediately, they went up in price massively. I guess you know that, right?
I know, and everybody say make another batch, but I don't like that. If I need to make new batch, it will be a new Phoenix.
Yeah, I'm excited for that. So the digital one, the Phoenix 4,
yeah.
You were involved in the design?
Yes, but only they use this envelope generator, they use some filters, they use one of the oscillators, they use part of them.
But it has like a wavetable oscillator?
And they have everything. There are four or five processors built using, they use them. For the sequence they use in the processor, they have a quartz oscillator that's analog, but that's controlled by a processor. They have a digital processor, audio processor for reverb and delay and I don't know what. But they are like me, they do things and then, okay, that's enough, they make hundreds, they are sold, okay,
yeah,
go on.
It's quite a lot of work to make 100 of these, right? Because you made them all by yourself, right?
I know. That's why I stopped with. It's nicer to develop new things than build it. It's nice to build those things in production, but after a year, then
you're over it. When I picked up the Phoenix One, it was from Mark Papin.
Mark Papin was at Synton. He was also at Synton, and the Phoenix One was a kind of cooperation with Mark. And I made some things, interfaces and that kind of things, he said, maybe we must make a synthesizer. Okay, and so I designed the synthesizer and I say to him, test it and if you don't like it, feedback and I will change it. But I never get feedback. So I don't know if it's good or not good because I think this is better, but it's different.
It has a lot more features, has a lot more in it.
Yes.
I think they're both really awesome synths. They both sound really good. They both have some different things you can think of them for sure. But that's an awesome bit of design.
Yeah.
Which was the, which filter was the Vactrol one talking about?
There was a bad filter. It's I don't know. This, now there is a state variable filters inside. I don't know the name about it. It's a quite simple filter because you have a dual Vactrol, then you have two parameters where you can control. But it was a Vactrol filter, yeah.
The wave multiplier seems to be a kind of original design. It's, I don't know anything else quite like it. I could be wrong, but.
No, I don't know. It's what I explained. It was left over of the oscillator, and so I want to keep that idea of a burst generator. But a burst generator is nice, but it's complex if you do it. Well, it's complex in calibrating because you have calibrated time, you have to calibrate the oscillator, you have more things inside. And how it sounds, yes. I like the sound, but it was not enough to put it in here. It had also, I think, 10 pot meters. You can set the burst, if you have a burst, then you have the waveform, let's say the frequency. You can count of the burst. You can set the step. You can do the decaying that thing or that direction. You have the time. That is nothing, and go on. And all those things must be voltage controlled. And I found out that it's too complex to work with it. It works if you have a computer with a lot of DA converters and you program the movements. Then you can do a lot of it. But it's LFOs and ADSR are not so. It's usual if you have, let's say, 5 or 6 control voltages which you can program. Otherwise, you have a simple burst.
On oscillator one, it has the output with the three different square waves.
Separately,
right? Separate phase on the...
No, these are basically the original. Square, and I add 2 other squares to it, and those are pulse width modulated by an internal LFO. There are 2 of them, and because there are 2 of them the same, but they are not always the components tolerance, they are changing a little bit, so you get that movement effect.
And if I'm right, trying to see it on here.
Yeah, he wants to do a different naming. The ship's off.
Well, I mean, the other thing I wanted to mention to you a little bit, I don't have so many questions for you, but the manual is awesome, I have to say. It's really clear, really precise.
I'm a technician.
I think
the manual is only to explain what's happening.
Yeah, but you need it. There's a lot to find out about on it.
Yes.
I think the manual and the fact that it's really concise and precise is really. Other manuals aren't like that, so I think that in itself is an awesome feature of the whole thing. do you write the manual? Do you write the manual?
Yes. Yes.
Nice.
Somebody has to do.
I guess people can get stuck in, right?
I should have asked this before maybe, but you initially mentioned that you worked with test equipment.
With? Yeah, well, the stretch.
I would assume that you worked with Ralph Phillips and that sort of.
No, I worked, I have some changing jobs, and one of the jobs was interim at Roland Schwarz, that making test equipment, radio stations, okay. And...
So that's kind of my point, which is, what would you say is the influence of you usually working with test equipment?
No, nothing.
Nothing?
Nothing.
But
nothing.
I'm trying to see if this is actually...
No.
You have ranges that go...
I'm always...
To 2 gigahertz,
no,
you know?
I know. I'm always interested in audio. When I was a little boy, I have a drive-in discotheque. I built my loudspeakers, amplifiers, mixers, and that kind of things. And I go on the road and I try to improve those things. And then I started at Synton. And then making the vocoders, the C-rings, the modular system, and that kind of things. So it's changing the thing, but I'm always interested in, let's say, sounds. It's music, but sounds. And also at that time at Synton, we experiment a lot. We made TETS filters with a lot of band filters, and we do feedback things and that kind of things. And you learn a lot of those if you experimental with those equipments. If you use them only if they as they are, but you can do a lot of more with them. Feedback or add things together, put something in the feedback loop or...
Yeah, exactly. But that's usually what you can achieve with test equipment because it's
yes. But it's
more of a philosophy. I mean
yes, no, it's not. But that was because they asked me to do that job for a short time, and it was something with test equipment. I was mainly involved with the radio and television, the transmitters. So, but they also make equipment for testing, but I was more of that.
I would love to see, I don't know if it's possible, but I would love to see like 2 minutes Peter using that instrument.
What? My ears are not so good.
I would love to see Peter using your instrument.
Like, oh.
If you have some favorite badge, if you have some way.
You have the same excuse as me, I'm not a musician. So.
Yeah. Maybe less so.
No, I mean, if we are finishing and passing to the...
Sure, I mean, I might need a minute to put something together.
Can I ask one question before you do that? I have one question. Why did you guys start with banana jacks?
At Synton, we use only banana jacks.
Okay, but why?
At that time, we making Eurorack equipment.
Uh-huh.
There was no name for it. It was Eurorack, but nobody knows it was Eurorack. It was Eurorack later. But we make Eurorack equipment, and you don't have cables for it, or you have that thick 6.3 millimeter cables. Mog using that, but if you have that size of modules,
it doesn't fit.
So we use this one. It was mini jack. Nobody used them. You cannot get the cables.
So it was just like a size constraint. That.
Yeah. And that's why we used it. And yeah, why not?
I love banana jacks. I just was like, cool.
Yes? Well, what was that your question?
I have one question about...
Wait a minute, yeah?
Production of this, did I understand correct that it's going to be produced here or...
They produce everything.
Yeah.
And I'm helping. Yeah. And now I want a beer.
Well, we have a beer. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.